Jesus, walking with the one who walks on the sea. And I'm gonna give my life to follow. Speak to me and I'll go wherever you lead, wherever you lead.
I'm worshipping an image of what only looks like me, surrounding you with limits of what my eyes can see. God, would you forgive me, restore the mystery? I hear your voice calling, calling, and
I'm gonna fix my eyes on Jesus, walking with the one who walks on the sea.
And
I'm gonna give my life to follow. Speak to me and I'll go wherever you lead, wherever you go, wherever you lead, that's where I'll go, that's where I'll be. The moment you call, the second you speak, that's when I'll go, step out and believe. Wherever you go, wherever you lead, that's where I'll go, that's where I'll be. The moment you call, the second you speak, that's when I'll go, step out and believe. Gonna fix my eyes on Jesus, walking with the one who walks on the sea.
And
I'm gonna give my life to follow. Speak to me and I'll go wherever you lead, wherever.
Good morning and welcome to our Palm Sunday morning service. I hope you've all got a palm cross because you are going to need it in a few minutes' time. I don't seem to have one, so if in that time someone could give me one, thank you. Greater love hath no man that he gives up his palm cross. It is a busy time of year, so bear with me. My name's Allan Coutts, by the way. I'm the vicar here. Welcome also if you're joining us via the live stream. Bear with us if we just share a few things that are going to be happening over the next few days. First of all, on Thursday, it is the Tenebrae, which Martin's going to say a word about.
Yes, on Monday, Thursday, we start here at 7:30 for coffee and hot cross buns. We ask people not to come too much before that because we're setting up. But we're starting here at 7:30 with hot cross buns and some drinks, and then the Tenebrae takes place at 8 o'clock. It's a very short service, but it's a very atmospheric service, and I think a very moving service, and it gives an opportunity to reflect upon the events that lead up to Good Friday. I just have two more readings I'm looking for somebody that might do for me. So if you think you can help me with one of those readings, please see me afterwards. Just two readings I need to fill. It guarantees you a place at the table and your own candle to put out. So first come, first served.
Thank you, Martin. And then the following day, Good Friday, there is a united service at St. James's Church. That's 10 o'clock in the morning. And then after that, we gather outside Sainsbury's for the March of Witness on Good Friday. That begins at around 11 o'clock. Easter Day, of course, we have a service here at 10:30, which is an all-age communion service. And then on Easter Monday, we're offering you the opportunity of not one, but two walks, one slightly more challenging and one dead easy. So if you would like to come for a walk on Easter Monday, and that will be followed by soup and bread rolls in the church rooms, there's a table at the back, and you can sign up on the sheet so that we know how many are coming for catering purposes. And then looking even further into the future, Val just wants to say a word about the UgandAid service at the end of next month.
It has been on the notice sheet, but it's kind of squashed between so many others. But the sign-up sheets for the UgandAid soup, bread and cheese lunch are at the back of church and by the display. So please sign up so we can work out how many people we're going to be catering for. And the other thing we asked for on the notice sheet was, because following the lunch, we're having an auction of promises. And we just need a few more promises. We've had things like baking a cake. We've had an offer of a family having 3 months Zen Judo sessions. We've also had a promise of a scale and polish from a dentist. So if you're desperate for one of those, but you would have to wait 3 months because of getting booked in. But you know, you can bid for that. So, but if you've got something simple, you know, like you can offer some babysitting or you can offer making something for somebody, then please come and see myself, Iva or Jane, so we can add them to the lots. And then the lots will be up on the notice board on the 7th of April. Thank you.
Thank you, Val. And squeezed in between all of that is, of course, the annual Broads Adventure led by our very own Jamie. And a good number of young people, as always, from Trowbridge are be going on that. So please do remember to be praying for the cruise on this the week after Easter week. Now, there's a group of amazing and slightly mad people who organise a sleepover once a year for Impact's youth group. And they've been sleeping over in the church rooms last night. And I'm going to hand over to Hannah now, and they're going to come and tell us what they've been up to. If you are watching on the live stream, as always, you'll hear voices, but you won't see faces. That's not a mistake, it's deliberate.
I think in our tardiness, some of us have forgotten where we're supposed to stand, but we'll figure it out as we go along, won't we? Right, okay, so Impact Sleepover. We met here yesterday at 2, and between 2 p.m. yesterday and now, we've been having lots of fun, so the youth are going to tell you more about what we got up to. So starting with Levi. If I can bring it to you, it's fine. Well, you are going to tell us more about what we got up to when we first arrived, yeah?
So basically, first we started off with two games. The first one was we had like a card with something on there, and then we had to like ask yes or no questions to other people and then guess what we were. And then we played a splat.
Do you want to explain what splat is to those who might not know?
Basically, you stand in a circle, and there's one person in the middle, and they like splat a person, if you're the one splatted, then you have to like duck, and then the two people on either side of you have to try splat each other.
Right, okay, so then we got up to something very exciting. So three people are going to tell us about our next adventure because there's lots to cover. Did you decide who's going to start? Okay.
Okay, so we went on a treasure hunt that Matt made and we just walked around Trowbridge looking for different things.
We had to... Oh yeah, we won. The people who came first, second and third all got prizes, and there were groups of about three, four.
It was raining and hailing and it was really cold.
So that lovely activity was planned by Matt Young. So it was a walk from the church in a big circle. We had to look for different things on the way. These pictures are, I think that one's cheating because that is not a selfie. There were prizes for the best selfie. The best selfie was someone with a dog. I don't know if we've actually got the one with a dog, but yes, we all went out. We got very cold and wet in the hail. That's the picture of the hail now to show you. Yeah, right, okay. Right, Toby is going to tell us about our speakers. So we had some people come to talk to us. He's going to tell us who came and what they told us.
Basically, some people came in and they were telling us how, I think they were like street pastors, right? They like walk around and like say like you've just come out of the pub and you're like really drunk and like you just take off your high heels like if you want to because you got bored. They would give you flip-flops so you don't, like, hurt your feet. And it keeps you safe so, like, you don't have cuts on your feet because that would hurt. Also, there was a woman who, I'm not sure exactly but where she does it, but she gives out, like, food and like, hot drinks, like, sandwiches to people who would like something when they run out of food or money. Like, say you went out and wasted your money on Puezo stuff, I don't know. I guess you were hungry. But, yeah, they give out food and water.
Yes, so we had various speakers who serve people in the community, so soup runs, street pastors. Some of us leaders talked about what else we do in the community as well. So we were just... thinking a bit more about how we might be able to serve people in the community as well. We looked at the story of the Good Samaritan and thought about where we might fit in that story. And there was lots of things to think about. We had some reflective time as well where we spent with God, seeing if he was saying anything to us. Right, so Gracie's next. She's going to tell us about all the food we had.
For dinner, we had jacket potato with beans and cheese and sausage. And then some cake and lots of cake. We had some crisps and popcorn. For breakfast, we had bacon sandwich.
Lots and lots of food, and most children bought cake, so we've had cake coming out our ears. Lisa just wanted to talk about who helped in the kitchen. Okay, so Lisa is just going to say thank you to the following people. So her mum, Victoria, Anastasia and Dasha helped us in the kitchen.
Thank you for washing our plates.
Brilliant, thank you. Right, Bethy's going to tell us about a chili game.
Right. So after dinner, we played this chili game where you would have like three peppers. Two of them would be normal peppers and then one would be like a chili pepper. And then everyone would try and guess who got the chili pepper. And unfortunately, I got it. It's very spicy. Wouldn't recommend.
Isaac is going to tell us about some of the favourite games we played as well. We played a lot of games. We're probably not going to cover them all, but...
So we played a game where so there were these tiles, and then we had to turn them over. One side was blue, one side was white, and there were two teams. And then the one who was doing the white sides won, and that wasn't me.
Right, Mim, there was, I'm hoping there's going to be pictures soon, a spontaneous activity last night. Do you want to tell us more about it? Right.
Yeah, we had a bit of a dance session in the hall last night where we played music and danced along to songs like the Macarena and the Cha-Cha Slide and other songs, and it was just a lot of fun.
So our lovely Jeff, who doesn't like the children to have sugar too near to bedtime because they might not sleep, it's definitely not anti a dance-a-thon that keeps them up and very riled. Interesting. Right. where are we? Isabella. Right. Why did Jeff then, after this, take us outside?
We went outside to look at the stars.
So we had a nice time looking at the stars. Jeff helped some people identify some of the different stars. Me and Nora got very confused because of the moving clouds. We thought they were all aeroplanes until we realised that was just... No, there weren't 100 aeroplanes in the sky. Right, okay. You can tell we were getting tired before we even slept. Right. Sam, yeah? What game did we finish with playing last night?
So we played sardines at the end of the night, like in the church in almost pitch black. And the most memorable place that was a hiding spot was when Toby Farnell and some other people hid down one of those drains. And a few other hiding spots were rolling up in carpets, hiding in dark cupboards and behind the organ.
And then...
And in there.
Lots of excitement and hyperactivity and screaming, so we did need a calming activity afterwards. So what did we do after that, Sam?
We watched a film, The Mitchells vs. the Machines. So it's basically about a family of four and a very weird dog trying to escape like a robot apocalypse.
Brilliant summary, I love it. Okay, Rebecca is going to tell us a little bit about whether she slept and her favourite parts of the weekend.
Well, my sleep wasn't very good because my mattress wasn't really a mattress. It was just lying on the floor for decoration, really. It wasn't very... There wasn't any air in it, and I think I only got about 4 hours of sleep because I was really uncomfortable. But I feel 100%, and probably my favourite part of the weekend was playing sardines in the dark church. And me, Samuel hid in the mat. We rolled him up in the mat. And then me and Zoe hid behind him. So that was really fun. That was my favourite part of the weekend.
Thanks for sharing. So, Mim, we had some early departures, didn't we? What happened?
Yeah, some people left early because of illness or commitments. So we had 25 people at the beginning, and then this morning some people had to also go early. So we got down to 16, which was a bit unfortunate, but still good numbers.
Right. Bethany, we're just finishing up. Is there anything else you'd like to say?
I think we're all just very thankful for the leaders. Like, it takes a lot of time and effort to put things like this up, like, hold our sleepovers a lot, you know? 26 children, a lot of food. I think we're just all really happy. It really went very well, and very thankful. So, hip hip.
Hooray!
Shall I do two more? Hip hip.
Hooray!
Hip hip.
Hooray! Thanks for your support. Ruth just wanted to make a really quick notice about food.
We've got some leftover things that can't go in the soup run in the trolley. So they're by the biscuits, if you want to help yourself to some bacon butties and cheese and things.
Thank you. Just a little practical thing adding on from that is all their gear, sleeping bags and so on, are still in the creche. So unfortunately we can't use the creche room today. But if you have an under 3-year-old and you want some toys and so on, there are toys at the back of the church and an area there that you can use with little ones. So feel free to do that. So we're going to sing a hymn together. If you'd all like to stand, please.
God, the servant king.
us now to follow Him, to bring our lives as a daily offering of worship to the servant King.
Please sit down, and Ollie is going to read the Palm Sunday story for us.
So the readings from Matthew 21, verses 1 to 11. Jesus comes to Jerusalem as king. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey, tied there, with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. "Say to daughter Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their coats on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of them and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
And a special prayer, the collect for Palm Sunday. Lord Jesus Christ, you humbled yourself in taking the form of a servant and in obedience died on the cross for our salvation. Give us the mind to follow you and to proclaim you as Lord and King, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. So this is where you're going to need your palm crosses. And during the singing of our next song, I'm going to invite anybody of any age who would like to, possibly led by Martin, to process around the center block of seating, waving your palm branches in worship as we sing together. And then at the end of the song, there will be repeated hosannas, and during those hosannas, young people and children seamlessly make your way through that door to join your groups in the church rooms. Please stand.
Hosanna in the heart.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. I see a generation rising up to take their place with selfless faith, with selfless faith. I see a near revival stirring as we pray and seek. We're on our knees, we're on our knees. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. 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 Heal my heart and make it clean. Open up my eyes to the things unseen. Show me how to love like you have loved me. Break my heart for what breaks yours. Everything I am for your kingdom's cause. As I walk from earth into eternity. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. 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 Hosanna in the
down. I'm sure they probably had a traffic jam on Palm Sunday as well with all those crowds. It's wonderful that we can work with young people to the extent that we do, and I'm just full of admiration for all of those who give up their sleep to do that. And the really good news is, though we live so close, Janet and I slept soundly as babies. As well as working with young people, another really important part of our life together is prayer, praying for one another, and particularly being able to offer to pray for people after our services. And I'm delighted that Andrew Sharland has recently agreed to step into the role of leading our prayer teams, and he's doing some work on just building up that side of our ministry. So I'd just love it if Andrew would come and share with us for a moment or two about the importance of that aspect of our church life. Thank you, Andrew.
Thank you. As Allan said, prayer ministry is and has been an integral part of our church life. And I just thought I'd say a few words. I'm going to use question words to make it clear. So firstly, what? What is it? So prayer ministry is creating the space and context for the power of God to work in people's lives. Through offering prayer ministry, we're seeking to serve God and one another as we cooperate with the Holy Spirit for his transforming work. Why? God in his goodness has chosen to work through the prayers of his people. From the moment we gave our lives to God, we seek to become the person that God made us to be. Prayer ministry is offered as an opportunity to invite God to work in our situations for healing, for encouragement, for wholeness, and for our relationships, and whatever. And I can testify in my own life that prayer ministry has played a huge part in my walk with God. Many of us were moved by the princess's news update, sitting on that bench in the garden. And I was struck particularly by one of the things she said, that she needed time to heal in spirit, mind, and perhaps we would say soul as well, spirit, mind, and body. And this is our prayer for the princess, for the royal family, and for ourselves. And this is really what prayer ministry is encouraging. So how? The model we use is the tried and tested method provided by New Wine. So firstly, we listen to what the person needs for in prayer, and we invite the Holy Spirit to bring to mind any thoughts, any pictures or scriptures, and in humility to share these with and pray with the person. It is a privilege to see God working in the lives of people in this way and to see burdens lifted. I said we follow the New Wine method, and we'll probably be told about New Wine at some stage, but I do recommend New Wine, and it's especially now it's back in Shepton Mallet. And if you are going to New Wine this year, I do recommend doing the prayer ministry training, which they usually offer at the beginning of, or even before the festival even starts. I did it again last year, and it's really worthwhile doing. There are two who's. First of all, who is it for? The answer to that is everyone. We are all fallen people saved by God's goodness. Our struggles do not stop when we become Christians. Our struggles are against principalities and powers. We can all benefit from the space and context that prayer ministry offers. So who is on the prayer ministry team? We're currently very few in numbers, and the pattern is that we pray in pairs, but we are particularly short of ladies at this time, so sometimes we have to have two men praying. But what we would say is that any ladies coming for prayer, we would seek to have a lady available to pray. So don't let that put you off. It's a requirement for all team members to have had a DBS check and the diocese basic safeguarding training, as well as prayer ministry training. When? Prayer ministry is offered at the front of church after nearly every Sunday morning service. We would love to pray with you, so please do come up for prayer as and when you want it. Let us press in further to what God has in store. And just finally, I'd say, if you have any questions, concerns, or comments, please do speak to Allan or one of the team. Thank you.
Thank you, Andrew. I can't always hear very well behind, so I'm not sure. Did you actually say that if anybody feels that God might be calling them to be part of that team, also we'd love to hear from you? I expect you did say that, but I can't always hear. Okay. We're going to continue now with a prayer of confession, which will be on the screen. Christ came in humility to share our lives. Forgive our pride. Lord, have mercy. Christ came with good news for all people. Forgive our silence. Lord, have mercy. Christ came in love to a world of suffering. Forgive our self-centeredness. Lord, have mercy. And we join in a few verses from Psalm 118. Open for me the gates of righteousness. I will enter and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord, through which the righteous may enter. I will give you thanks, for you answered me. You have become my salvation. The stone the builders have rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and is marvelous in our eyes. The Lord has done to this very day. Let us rejoice and be glad. Lord, save us. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. The Lord is God, and he has made his light shine on us. So Robert is now going to lead us in our prayers of intercession.
I felt to concentrate a little bit on the Holy Spirit this morning in prayer, because as we know, the Holy Spirit is here and with us. With us all in a very powerful way. I just want to read 2 Corinthians 3:17. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Lord, we ask that the freedom of your wonderful Holy Spirit would be here now, so that we can pray and worship you in spirit and truth, and come to know you as you really are. Thank you, Lord, for all the wonderful children that come into this church, and thank you, Lord, for the Broads adventure in April. May your spirit and holy presence be upon all the children and adults, Lord. Look after them, and may they experience many miracles and special holy moments. Father, I thank you that you are growing and anointing our worship team so that they can lead the people into a Holy Spirit flow of worship. Enable all of us to move in and with the Holy Spirit as we seek you in praise, worship, and adoration. May we become an expression of your Spirit as your presence comes to bless us. Thank you, God, that our prayer ministry team is growing and that you are giving us your faith and wisdom in order to minister to people as you would want us to. We look to the example of Jesus as we pray for all our sick and recovering people. And may we just think of anybody who we personally know who we want to ask God for healing right now, we just have a moment of silence. Jesus said, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you." Thank you for Trowbridge, our town, and that you are bringing the right people here. Show each one of us how to pray and act so that we can bring the peace of Jesus to our family and neighbours. Jehovah Jireh, you are our provider, and we thank you that you have provided us with a great leader in Allan here at St. Thomas's over the last 25 years. We are looking forward to the next season when we thank you in advance for the perfect successor to Allan, who we know will hear your voice and lead us in your will and purpose for this church. We ask that you would give us the patience, vision, flexibility, and the courage we need. Thank you for the team of leaders that we have to enable the transition to be as smooth as possible during the coming interregnum. Lord, thank you for our nation. Help us, your people, to hear your voice more clearly. Have the courage to act on your word and do our part as the body of Christ to usher in your kingdom. We ask that you would bring godly order to our government and give our political leaders integrity and wisdom. Be with our royal family at this time as they battle sickness and the prying media. Give them wisdom and strength. Bring healing to King Charles and the Princess of Wales, and show them that they must trust and believe in you as Queen Elizabeth II did. Father God, as Prince of Peace, we cry out for a stop to the violence and suffering in our world. We call for the peace of Jerusalem, peace in Ukraine, Yemen, Myanmar, Sudan, and many other countries. Pour out your spirit in these places and bring comfort and healing to the hurting. We also pray that you would be with the families of the terrorist attack in Moscow and that there would be no repercussions to this. We finish by looking to you, Almighty God. We cry out that you would pour out your Holy Spirit on us afresh so that we would come to know you more as our provider, healer, salvation, deliverer, fortress, helper, shepherd, strength, and rock. Amen. We now pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
So now feel free to stand if you are comfortable to do so. Whilst the worship team lead us in a time of praise. And you may wish to wave these again if you want to.
exalt thee. I exalt thee. I exalt thee. O Lord, I exalt thee.
I have felt your
touch, more intimate than lovers.
Worship you, Jesus. Come, Holy Spirit, fill our hearts. Help us to see Jesus afresh. Open our minds, transform our minds, Lord. Fill our souls with your presence. Praises to the Lord.
I exalt thee. I exalt thee. I exalt thee.
I exalt thee, O
Do sit down. Robert, in his prayers, alluded to the fact that yesterday, as it happens, was the 25th anniversary of my licensing as vicar of St. Thomas's and West Ashton. And then the following Sunday, Palm Sunday, was my first service here in this church. And I'd be fascinated to know, just out of interest, how many present today would have been present at one of those services. You don't have to remember anything about the service or even to be sure whether you were actually there. But if it's likely that you were there, just wave a hand. Wow, look at that. Isn't that amazing? How many people have stuck it out for 25 years and in some cases even longer. Out of interest, I looked back at my sermon from that Palm Sunday service 25 years ago, which I happened to have kept, just because I was interested to see what I was saying all those years ago. And the theme was walking with God, using the analogy of my love for walking in the countryside. So nothing much different there. And here are just a few quotes from what I said that day. This first one's quite, ouch, one of those. It would be unwise of me on my first Sunday to make any rash promises, but I will make this one promise, that with God's help, I will endeavor to walk with him all my time here. Well, I hope that I've kept that promise more or less. And I continued, what does walking with the Lord mean? It's about staying close to him, being with him where he is. So if he wants to walk along the River Biss, that's where I'm going too. I don't think I knew much about the River Biss at that time. No, it is, there is part of it that's very nice to walk along. If he wants to take the canal towpath, that's okay with me. And if he wants to ride a donkey into Jerusalem, then I'll follow. Well, I've certainly walked the Kennet and Avon towpath to Bradford, talking and listening to the Lord, probably some several thousand times since then. And as I've walked along, I've frequently meditated on some verses from Psalm 25, which will always be associated in my mind with that stretch of the canal. Show me your ways, O Lord, teach me your paths. Guide me in your truth and teach me, for you are God my Saviour, and my hope is in you all day long. Well, back to that sermon from the 28th of March 1999, which said that you need to do three things when you go for a walk. Fix your eyes on the destination. Travel light and push through weariness. On the subject of the destination, I said this: we want to see his kingdom come and his will done on earth as in heaven. Together with all the Christians in the town, we want to bring Christ to Trowbridge and Trowbridge to Christ. Again, no change there. On my second point, travelling light, I went on to say, walking with God involves leaving some things behind, because it's essential to travel light. I'm talking about things which may be good, but not essential, and in the end, will just weigh us down. Those words may well come to haunt Janet and I as we try to downsize or sort out our lives over the next few months. We're finding it really challenging going through 25 years plus of accumulated possessions. But you know, decluttering is actually a good analogy for the sort of spiritual stock-taking and shedding of unnecessary encumbrances we're encouraged to do during Lent. Are there habits or activities that God is calling us to jettison in order to travel lighter with him from now on? There's still a week of Lent to ask yourself that question. And finally, on perseverance, pushing through the pain barrier on a walk, I said, the real breakthrough times come when it's tough, but you keep going anyway. What a friend of mine used to call the daily plod with God. You're so determined to reach that destination that something inside you keeps going, even though every muscle is screaming, stop and rest. So reassuringly, there was nothing in that sermon that I want to disagree with or unsay 25 years later. In fact, I want to positively encourage you, St. Thomas's, Kingfisher, St. John's, keep walking with God after we've gone, throughout the interregnum, throughout the process of appointing a new vicar, and then walk with them into all God has for you together in the future. Well as being the 25th anniversary of my induction service, yesterday was also the fourth anniversary of the start of the first COVID lockdown. That strange period when we all suddenly found we had nothing to do on Sunday mornings. Do you remember that? I rather liked it, actually. And this time, 4 years ago, we were making our first attempts at online worship by means of those simple YouTube videos, which were, at that stage, getting heady numbers of views, 200, 300, even 400 views a week. When I caught myself checking how many views we'd had every Monday morning, I realized the insidious power of social media with its followers and friends to give you the illusion, and it is an illusion, of popularity and success. In fact, a look at the figures some other churches were getting soon brought me down to earth. Compared to them, we were very small fry indeed. Jesus could have felt like that on Palm Sunday, could have felt he'd finally made it, that the tide of popular opinion was with him at last, as he was given that rapturous welcome into God's city, Jerusalem. The masses had finally caught up with Peter's confession of a few months earlier, hailing him as the Messiah. It could have been a heady experience for Jesus, seeing cloaks and palm branches spread out before him and being greeted with shouts of Hosanna, Son of David. This could have been the high point of his ministry when he felt he'd finally made it. But Jesus was under no illusions about the bittersweet nature of that event. He was well aware that what lay before him was not more and more popular acclaim, but rejection, betrayal, mocking, crucifixion. He knew full well that the humble king riding on a donkey was destined to be the suffering servant, carrying his people's sorrows, pierced for their transgressions, and healing them by his wounds. And there was no way his head was going to be turned by the transient praise of that Palm Sunday crowd. A bit like my sermon back in 1999, Jesus had fixed his eyes on a destination. He'd thrown off everything that might weigh him down and was absolutely determined to push through and finish his journey, even at unimaginable pain and cost. In the light of all that, our addiction to YouTube views, Facebook friends, or Twitter X followers all looks pretty shallow and pathetic. The Princess of Wales's shameful treatment by parts of the media in recent weeks shows how empty the world's bouquets and brickbats really are. Jesus shows us the way to true greatness is through sacrificial love. A few days after that first Palm Sunday service, I took part in my first Good Friday March of Witness here in Trowbridge. And as I recall, it was a gloriously sunny spring day that year. Well, this year, my final Good Friday here, I've been asked to preach at that United service at St. James. And they may not escape a few reminiscences along the lines that I've shared this morning, but that will just be an excuse to preach about the one thing that hasn't changed in all those years, or even since my ordination, even longer, 40 years ago, or my conversion to Christ, 50 years ago. The one thing that hasn't changed, the power of the cross. That central Christian message still makes sense to me, just as it did when I first properly understood it, aged 15. Because even then I realized that there's something tragically wrong with the human race. And I could see that a radical solution was needed to put it right, more radical than anything human beings are capable of. And as a teenager, it made sense to my heart, and it still does, that in some mysterious way I'll never fully understand, Jesus' death and resurrection is that radical solution to what's wrong with the world and what's wrong with us. The Bible gives a number of pictures of how that worked. A sacrifice for sin, a scapegoat, a benefactor paying off our debts, an advocate pleading in our defense, a physician healing a deadly disease, a champion fighting on our behalf, defeating sin, death, the world, the flesh, and the devil. All those pictures, all those analogies speak deeply to me, but none of them fully explains how the cross of Christ eventually is going to put everything right. And yet, deep within, I believe it will. That's what I'm going to be, without any spoilers, that's what I'm going to be sharing on Good Friday morning. I'll tell them that I still believe the cross of Jesus changes everything, that it still has a strange attraction for me, that there's wonder-working power in the blood, that the heart of the Christian faith has nothing to do with us and what we do. It's all to do with him and what he has done. That the cross of Christ is God's answer to the ills of this world. All sin, sickness, misery, addiction, mental illness, poverty, war. He's done what no one else could do, and what he's done is enough. It's foolishness to the wise of this world, but for those who are called to believe in every generation, the cross is the wisdom of God and the power of God. I'm really looking forward to spending one more Holy Week and Good Friday with you all here in Trowbridge, as together we glory in the cross of Christ. Amen. Please stand, and we're going to sing our closing hymn together.
Strong in the Savior's love, through the
So as we again consider the great gift of Christ and all that he gave for us, we offer these poor gifts of our own as one part of our worship and response of gratitude to him. Amen. Christ crucified, draw you to himself to find in him a sure ground for hope. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you, now and always. Amen. As we heard earlier, the prayer ministry team will be over there near the organ to pray with you. And coffee and refreshments will be served on this side of the church. So let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, Amen.